This video is on female hair loss, everything you need to know from medical, surgical, and it's a really difficult video because there's so many types of female hair loss, and there's people that are born with just a high hairline that want a female hairline lowering, which I'm gonna do a separate video on, and then there are women that have traction hair loss, there's eyebrow hair loss, which is a separate video as well. All these components are so complex, but I'll have a separate video on eyebrow transplants, one on specifically for female hairline lowering, especially for the women that are just born with a high hairline. But this is talking about female hair loss and hair restoration. So I'm gonna divide this into two components, which is gonna be the medical side and the surgical side. So what's important when we look at the medical side is to divide the medical side down further into treating the cause and treating the effect. So medical hair loss, what does that mean? What it means is, think about this. If I transplant hairs up here and you still have medical hair loss and you're still losing hair, you're gonna think, I need another transplant, I need another transplant, I need another transplant. So oftentimes for women that are losing hair, we need to control the hair loss and not just do the surgery. In some cases, you don't even need the surgery. And so if you're thinning, progressively thinning and thinning, thinning, you really should, and especially unstable hair loss, you really need some kind of medical therapy or medical evaluation. So from treating the cause is something, what is causing hair loss? It's oftentimes low thyroid, it's a hormonal imbalance for the women. It is a low iron level, especially young women with high menstruation, with a lot of blood loss that can cause a hair loss for older women. Postmenopausal, it's usually some hormonal changes, you know, into more male hormones dominance. The problem is I don't do all that there. I don't evaluate that. So if you have those issues, I definitely love for you to get your hormones evaluated, everything before you come to see me, because I just don't treat it. When you come in, I'm going to send you out for that anyways. So if you've got that medical side of things where you're trying to find out what's going on, if you want to, where do I find all this information? On my website, hairtx.com, under the female metabolic evaluation, you can look at the list of things that I ask, but you can also just ask your OBGYN, you can ask your internist or family doctor about those things. But treating the cause means, what is causing my hair loss? And unfortunately, a large part of women, 30% of women over age of 30 lose hair, and a lot of times those numbers look pretty normal. So what do you do when all those numbers look normal? Is there something else you can do? Well, there's a couple other things that are a little bit off the beaten path that I'll just briefly mention here. One is functional medicine. What functional medicine is, it's still in the realm of Western doctors that are treating you and looking at you, but you're looking at, okay, well, your numbers are normal, okay, the normal range, but is there something else that I can do to make it even better? Can I optimize it? So my thyroid is pretty normal, can I get it better? And I've got someone in my wellness building that can help you with that as well, but that's usually a cash issue. In other words, insurance doesn't cover that. But optimization of your hormones, optimization of iron levels, those things a lot of Western doctors are not really versed to treat, because if you don't have cancer, heart disease, diabetes, or your numbers are in the normal range, they figure you're healthy and you're gone. So functional medicine is one component. I also believe in cupping, which is weird because I've got some cupping, which is just toxin reduction. A lot of times toxins are there that can cause our bodies not to be healthy. I have a lady in my building that does a great job for that. So treating the cause is not something I do. I'll send that out to my colleagues to work on that. What I do treat is the effect. In other words, now you have hair loss, what can I do to fix the hair loss? Not treat the cause, the root cause of it, but let's fix the effect. So fixing the effect is gonna be based on a few things. One is gonna be a topical minoxidil. I use a compounded version because oftentimes there's an inflammatory component toward hair loss in women. So using this compounded version can be very helpful in women that are losing hair. And also, if you're postmenopausal, and there's no risk of birth defects, et cetera, there's been studies that have shown finasteride or things that are used for men can also be very helpful, whether it's topical, oral, or a combination thereof. And I know that's complex, but we can have that narrative and discussion when you're here with me. But those are sort of the core medical ways of treating it. Other ways, low-level laser therapy can be very effective. Oftentimes, though, you buy this very inexpensive one that doesn't have any true diode lasers there. So I'm talking about a really authentically good quality, high-level laser that I do offer in my office as well. And then Beyond laser therapy and beyond minoxidil therapy, Nutrafol, which is basically, and we offer that also less expensively than what's on Amazon, but Nutrafol is a supplement. There's been a huge push the last couple of years to look at supplementation because a lot of times the hairs are just unhealthy. And I sometimes look at hair and I can see it's unhealthy. I did a podcast on unhealthy hair. So that is part of it. And then just basically a natural DHT blocking shampoo, even if you only wash your hair a few times a week, can also be very helpful in terms of therapy for hair loss. So that's a very broad summary of how I look at female hair loss in terms of the medical category. Let's talk about the surgery. So for surgery, when do I do surgery on a female? So one is I don't do surgery if someone is rapidly losing hair. If the hair is unstable, there's no way I can put hair in there and then all of a sudden you're losing that more hair around it. It's not good. So I need to have a stable pattern of hair loss. The other thing is there's a bizarre condition called scarring hair loss, frontal fibrosing alopecia in African American central centrifugal cicatricial alopecia. Scarring hair loss is lupus. There's bizarre conditions where surgery is not a great option for those patients. How do I know you have it? Either your dermatologist told you this, there's a biopsy proven, or I'm gonna look at you and say, look, you're not a good surgery candidate. So scarring hair losses, unstable hair loss, are usually not good candidates for surgery. Or if the donor hair has what's called DUPA, diffuse unpatterned alopecia, which means that the donor hair is just so poor that no matter what I do to bring it up here, you're gonna lose those grafts, you're not gonna survive well. Those are probably three big categories of patients that I just don't wanna be doing a hair transplant on. But the interesting thing is, unlike for men, where I worry about them going to complete baldness, women, if they've got good donor hair, they're not going to shave their scalp. I'm not so worried about necessarily creating an unnatural pattern for them. I have a lower threshold to say, you know what, I think surgery is a good option for you. So that's the next question, is how do I do the surgery? And I get this question all the time. You know, there's two methods of doing surgery. There's FUE and FUT. I literally have written the only book in the world on FUE, and I'm about to write a two-volume set on FUE, so I'm very passionate about FUE as a technology and technique. And since 2018, there's been incredible, incredible technological advancements with FUE. However, FUE to me makes no sense in women. I rarely, if ever, would offer a female FUE. First of all, the majority of FUE is shaved. No woman wants to shave your scalp. If it's non-shaven, it takes 2 days to harvest this. And it's you're lying face down for, you know, a long time to try to get the hairs out. But the other reasons too is that women have their sweet spot of the best donor hair right here in the center where the FUT is being able to be harvested. For me to do FUE all over the scalp, taking poor hair for a transplantation makes no sense. Women also don't shave their hair. So if I do a really seamless, beautiful incision where you can't even see it, to me, it makes no sense to have to harvest all over the scalp. The other thing that's interesting is that my colleague that did a study where he did half an FUE, half an FUT on a male, the only difference the male felt was on the side of the FUE was much thinner in feeling, and women don't want to have hair that feels thin, not only looks thin. So for me, hands down, FUT or strip procedure, you can look at my website of how beautiful my incisions are. In the worst case scenario, we could have 3 millimeters. Most cases, it's almost impossible to find my incision. So for women, hands down, FUT makes sense for them. I just don't understand FUE for women, except marketing people that try to sell you something and try to, because they don't even know how to do FUT. That's the reason majority of doctors now that are just quasi doing hair only offer FUE. So that's the problem, is women are being suckered and something doesn't work. In fact, I just saw a lady that I just scheduled for FUT because she had FUE. There's like 10 grafts growing here, 10 over here. She needed a whole hairline reconstruction. It was a complete farce. So FUT is the way that I'm going with women, almost hands down. Now, if you have a question or more detail, ask me those questions. I'll be more than transparent and honest to talk to you about the limitations of both, but I do offer both, but those are for men. For women, I just don't understand why I would do FUE. There's so few indications for FUE for women. So let's talk a little bit about the surgery. The trick with women when they're losing hair is that you cannot take the hair and scatter it to the winds. You need to focus and concentrate. So in my book that I've written about hair loss, specifically also with female hair loss, is I concentrate the graft. So if it's a female hairline lowering, again, that's a separate video just talking for about women that are just born with a high hairline. that, but if we're talking about just reframing the front, then I concentrate the grafts there. Like the lady I just told you about, I'm gonna be focused on the front and her left hair part and a little bit of frontal temporal recession. But some women, what I tell them is, what I've gotta do is select the best hairstyle and focus on it. For example, some women part from the left. I'll say, look, let's do the left part, let's do the central forelock and maybe a little of the crown. I call that a dumbbell design, which means a circle, small circle, and a line. And the line can either be on the left part, can be the middle, or can be the side. But if I start scattering everywhere, you don't necessarily see a good result. So you have to sort of pick a part, pick a hair part that looks the best for you. And say, look, I like to part my hair in the middle, let's do that. It's better to do that than go all over the place. And so that design that I talk about is either a T shape, which is like this, an L shape or a backwards L shape going this way, or that's a backwards L shape. So doing those patterns are what I'm gonna talk to you about during a consult. Again, unless we're talking about a hairline lowering and maybe less of a density issue or a combination thereof. So focusing and concentrating on that really makes a big difference. I encourage you, even though I'm going to talk a separate video about the female hairline lowering, even if you're not born with a high hairline and you just want to know about female hairline lowering because that's where the concentration of your issue is, I encourage you to also watch that video on female hairline lowering because it's going to talk about both situations about how I design a female hairline lowering procedure. So that's the basic surgery. Let's talk a little bit about the nature of the procedure, the recovery, and the results. So the procedure is gonna be done under what's called level 2 conscious sedation, which is just a little bit of anesthesia. It's like having a few cocktails. You're not gonna feel the injection. I'm only provided for the first few minutes, but you feel so groggy that you sort of fall asleep for the rest of the procedure. It's a long procedure, sometimes it can be 10 hours. But the nice thing is, unlike all the other places out there where they're doing it under oral sedation, you really don't feel that discomfort. You're very, very comfortable. You're not feeling anxious, and it's a pretty easy, painless experience, and the whole day you don't feel the weight of that time. By about lunchtime, I've already done my design, I've already done my harvesting, already done my closure, and you may not even remember me being in the room for 5 hours, but as you sit up, we're gonna give you a lunch. In the afternoon, my staff were placing, and so you're gonna feel like you're in my office for about 3 to 4 hours, and we're done about between 3:30 to 6:30 p.m. roughly, depending on how big the session is, how hard the dissection is, how fine the grafts we need to dissect. But somewhere between 3:30 and 6:30 we'll be done. At the end of the procedure, you cannot drive home. Someone has to drive you home. And then we're gonna see the next day, check on everything, make sure you're doing okay. So I wanna talk a little bit about the nature of the recovery. So a lot of people ask me, what's the recovery like? So one is pain. Oftentimes my patients don't have very much pain. It's not that uncomfortable. Rarely, this morning I had to do it. A lady had some discomfort back here from yesterday. I just put some Botox in, believe it or not, knocked it out. I do that once or twice a year. I mean, it's very, very uncommon I have to do that. But my FUT strip procedures just don't hurt very much. It's not like what other places have where it's very uncomfortable afterwards. It really should not be the way that I do it. And I can spend an hour telling you about why that is. And if you have a question, I'd be more than happy to elaborate on why that is when you come and see me. But in terms of the recovery, bruising typically should be almost none. I don't rarely see bruising. Swelling, only about 15%, 1-5% of my patients have swelling. That swelling lasts usually about 3 to 5 days. In rare cases, it can last 7 to 8. And again, 85% of my patients don't even have the weird swelling. If you have the weird swelling, just wear sunglasses, it'll cover it up for the first few days. Scabs are the biggest offender. You're gonna see weird scabs up here where I transplant. If you can have a hairstyle that can cover it, that's great. That would be really, really wonderful. And wearing the hairstyle will be able to cover the scabs until you can rub them off. The scabs are rubbed off in 7 days. And so that makes the recovery not so bad. The backside incision is pretty much hidden. You're not gonna see that even walking out of my office. So in terms of social contact, if you can cover this here and you don't have much visibility, it could be a day out. If you may have to wear a scarf or a baseball cap or something or a hat to cover it for that week. And that could be the nature of the recovery. Stitches come out about 2 to 3 weeks after the procedure. You don't feel very much discomfort with that, but it's pretty fast. In terms of going back to working out, I say listen to your body. Don't force yourself. Don't go crazy. Don't push yourself. The only thing is, you can shower 24 hours out after the procedure, a day afterwards, but no tub bathing where you're under the water or swimming for about 6 weeks. I don't want you to be in dirty water if possible. The other things is traumatic sports. Nothing that can, you know, impact, you know, karate, something that would, you know, hit you. That's about the only thing I would say. I wouldn't want that for about 6 weeks or so. Otherwise, in terms of just general working out, just listen to your body. And that's really what I would, you know, advise. In terms of when the grafts grow in, I've seen as early as 4 months, but honestly, it's oftentimes about 5, 6, 8 months that you start getting a good expression of things. And remember, women need oftentimes longer hair, and it only grows about an inch a month. So over time, it gets longer and longer and longer and longer, and so that full expression may take a year. But a lot of my female patients are quite happy between 5, 6, 8 months, but they're really full expression maybe 12 to 18 months out. Do you need a second transplant? My goal after one surgery is to get you done. But some of my patients come back and say, you know, could I have a little more density here or there? And I would usually like to wait at least a year so that we let the hairs grow in, and then what you thought at 6 to 8 months you needed another surgery, you don't need it. And so I always encourage my patients to wait before we rush back to do another surgery. And plus, I want all the donor area to heal as well. Too. And the reason I think my patients get such amazing results after a single session is, first of all, it's my design. It's obviously the protection of the grafts. It's also my staff, how good they are in terms of placement. They do amazing work. And then finally, it's the ATP, hyperthermosol, PRP, and acel, which are a mouthful to describe fertilizers, because the hairs have these great fertilizers that allow the hairs to grow better during the transplantation process. So I hope this video gives you a very large overview of everything you need to know about female hair loss and hair restoration from medicine to surgery.